Let me start by saying that Lake Mungo is not only a great horror movie, but my all-time favorite horror movie. Now, that shouldn't mean anything to you yet, seeing as I could have only seen Tommy Wiseau's The Room or, say, Birdemic 2. But let me explain to you how objectively and unarguably awesome this film is, and you can make up your own mind from there. Before I do, though, I want to offer anyone who hasn't seen Lake Mungo, or anyone who has seen it but wants to revisit it with fresh eyes, the chance to bookmark this video, come back to it later, and run your analysis of the film up against mine.
Strangest book I ever read.
This review has literally all of the spoilers, so if you want to discover it for yourself, I'd advise clicking out. From what I've read of Lake Mungo's reviews, it seems most people have missed a vital part of what makes this movie great, and just pinned it as another found footage cliche, just one of the many movies with nothing much going for it except that you were jolted a few times in your seat. Films have the potential to move you to tears, bring you to new realms of despair and love, but most horror movies these days just make you do this. Ugh. What is that soy sauce?
Yeah.
Oh my god, there's so much! You used all my soy sauce on this! I can't stress enough that Lake Mungo is so much more than this. I must have watched it more than any other film, except maybe Land Before Time, and stumbled blindly in the dark all the way to figuring it out. It's definitely not obvious. It goes against all the expectations we have seared into our minds by the cheap, jolty horror films of the day. Anyway, if you wanted to watch this movie, I've given you enough time to find the X. Unless, of course, you're a glutton for punishment, in which case, keep living on the edge. You've got 1 second until spoilers. So Joel Anderson's mockumentary-style film, Lake Mungo, begins after Alice Palmer goes missing while picnicking with her family at Novel Dam near Ararat, Australia. Potential shout-out to David Lynch's Twin Peaks series there with Alice's last name. So after the 16-year-old disappears and her family can't find her, they are forced to drive home backwards because reverse is the only gear they can get their car into. That night, Alice's father, Russell Palmer, leaves the porch light on for Alice, which sets an ominous tone similar to the one set in Juan Antonio Bayona's Spanish horror film El Orfanato. And if you haven't seen that yet, you absolutely should. As the family's hope of finding Alice turns stale, news footage surfaces that her body has been found in a stormwater grate at the bottom of the dam. And we see her body being exhumed, which alongside the actor's part improvised acting style, aids in the solidification of the film's realism. John Brawley, the cinematographer, was really spot on in this film.
No, I disagree with that. But I don't have the vernacular nor the patience to express my opinion properly, so I'm just gonna go with what I know best. Go kill yourself. Yeah, that'll do it.
Russell feels specified gender pressure as Alice's father to identify Alice's body at the morgue.
I thought that was my responsibility as Ellie's dad, you know.
Ensuing is lots of sad footage of Alice dancing in slow motion in home videos her family had collected, lots of photos, discussions of her life from family and friends. There's some grieving, and to balance that out, some classic male emotional suppression.
He was working a lot at that point.
I was really grateful that I had my work. You know, I just wanted to get on with it.
And finally, mention of strange noises being heard around the Palmer household. Alice begins to show up in photos, one that Matthew takes of the backyard every month, and one caught by a farmer down at Novel Dam where she drowned. So with all these sightings piling up, doubts are harboured by June about whether the body found in Novel Dam was actually Alice's. So in accordance with the apparently newly established eighth stage of grieving, they actually exhume her body and yes, confirm it was her, she's dead. In response to reports of continuing activity, Alice's brother sets up cameras around the house with hope that he can capture evidence of Alice's spirit. Upon reviewing these tapes, it seems he's captured his sister walking down the hallway. And just so we're on the same page, I'm well aware of how cliche this all sounds so far, and that pretty much every event thus far in the film has aided in the establishment of a very stock standard horror plotline.
Hey, Murd, you gotta check this out, man.
What is it?
Check that out.
Where?
Look a bit closer, man. Can't you see it?
Oh, shit.
Looks like the Illuminati's gotten to the YouTubes. You know what that means.
Stop the bunker.
I'm gonna get me some green beans. I'm gonna get me some chili.
What about damn peaches?
Man, we're gonna have some peaches too.
Oh,
yeah.
Going to the bunker. Gonna have myself some peaches.
Anyway, June has a psychic session with a guy named Ray Schultz.
Australia's WOG psychic of choice.
They capture some more evidence on Matt's camera, and then he admits to fabricating it all. Every single mildly disconcerting thing in the movie thus far has been fabricated. Then it shows how he did it all, and explains he did it for the purpose that Alice's body would be re-examined, and this would allow his mother, who didn't examine the body the first time, the closure she so desperately required. Especially given it was so explicitly stated that her relationship with Alice was rocky and probably ended amidst bitterness. This was a point of defeat for lots of viewers, and myself admittedly, this far into the movie. And all that's really left of what was building up is a few questionable noises they heard around the place, and maybe a dream that June had that her daughter was standing at the end of her bed, dripping wet from the dam, which admittedly is a fairly troubling premise, one which I went to the trouble of recreating, by the way, by planting seeds in my friend's head for 2 weeks about a woman I heard in his bedroom, to which he replied,
I mean, my memory is like falling to pieces, but I'm pretty sure that I did not give laid on a Monday or any day of the week.
And then buying a wig and a nightie from an Asian import store and dressing up in it, and then standing at the end of his bed one night, resulting in this. Other than the dream, the only thing suggesting anything out of the ordinary to even give this film its horror genre listing at this point was a scene where the father explains going into Alice's old room and then seeing Alice at her desk, casually sending a text message. First few times through, this was just another part of an awkward, cliché-heavy plot. But something about the obvious scripted specificity of the sighting and the normalcy of Alice's actions in Russell's recollection struck me as odd. Followed by the fact that she yells at him to get out of her room after his shoe squeaks on the floor. Like it was a reasonably normal reaction, not some ghost whose mouth opens that bit too wide. So I was jolted right out of the Matrix-like days years of lazy script writing left me in. I was left blinking and covered in pink embryonic goop in that weird Matrix womb pod thing, thinking,
well, she tossed it!
Oh, that was a bad idea. Oh, man. Spirits of young people in films aren't meant to be just like normal young people. That would ruin the effort film and literature have exerted to make innocence somehow a terrifying premise. What with the sallow eyes, blank expressions, and that feeling that they're going to mess you up in some unimaginable way. What would all the bad horror writers rely on to scare people if, say, Samara from The Ring were to crawl up out of the well, black hair draped limp and lifeless over her face, concealing an iPhone 6 in a tweet saying, God, I'm so glad I'm out of that well. The lighting down there was terrible, just could not get a good picture. What if instead of Reagan from The Exorcist being possessed by the demon Pazuzu, she had constructed an elaborate attention-seeking ruse because she felt neglected by her narcissistic actress mother? What if the Omen was just some unwashed little brat with snot dripping out of his nose riding a scooter and swearing at you from a safe distance away? That scene in Alice's bedroom kept repeating on me, but unlike that part, the reason for Anderson writing in the hoax tapes becomes resolved for us. The plot takes an interesting twist when, upon more in-depth review of the captured footage, a man is found in Alice's old room, pining around near her fireplace looking for something. It was
our neighbor. ratatouille.
Unfortunately for him, he doesn't find what he was looking for, and instead the family's attention is drawn to the fireplace, where a videotape is found lodged on an inner shelf above the hearth. On the tape is blurred footage of Brett Toohey and his wife, whom Alice would frequently babysit for, on their bed with Alice, in what must be a lengthy paragraph of illegal activity. The immediate reaction from the Palmer family was that this must be why Alice's spirit remained earthbound, and that probably, in alignment with every other film about ghosts ever made, Alice wanted them to know her deep, dark secret before she passed on, that she was screwing the neighbors. And then, being presented with evidence of the neighbors statutorily raping Alice, the cops just lose him. Can't find him anywhere, he just evaporated, apparently. After this little twist, Ray the psychic admits to seeing Alice for several months before her passing. After June finds his business card in Alice's diary that was in the locked box alongside the tape. He admits Alice sought his counsel, where she'd complain of frightful dreams she'd have. This scene here is another pertinent one to remember for later.
Alice came to see me because she was upset. She was a very troubled person.
I had a dream last night. I was cold and wet. I felt heavy, like I'd been drugged. And when I woke up, these sensations didn't go. I was feeling sick and confused, and I was starting to get scared. I needed to see Mum to talk to her. I stumbled to her room, and as I stood there at the bed watching them, I was overcome by this intense sadness. Then the sadness turned to fear. I just stood there paralyzed with fear, and I realized there was nothing that they could do for me anymore. I've never felt so utterly alone. Everything felt wrong. My body, the way things looked. Then I realized that there was something wrong with me. I started to cry standing there at the foot of the bed.
The plot takes another turn as Alice's ex-partner shows the family some footage he thinks might be helpful for the case that is filmed on some sort of root vegetable. The footage vaguely alludes to a troubled Alice among peers on a school camp at Lake Mungo, all of whom appear to be enjoying a nice game of running around in the dark, yelling. Fun. In this footage, it is vaguely evident that Alice is burying something under a tree. The family immediately drives in a more productive gear down to Lake Mungo. After identifying the tree where Alice had been digging, they unearth what Alice buried there. Upon opening the plastic bag, they find a gram of the speed they'd evidently been taking in order to justify the footage on the ex's phone. No, her phone and a bracelet she wore all the time were recovered. At this point, I've literally spoiled the whole film, so I really hope you've watched it already. But upon inspecting Alice's phone, the family find a video. It begins with Alice wandering across the rocky expanse of Lake Mungo, a chilling quote reiterated throughout the film playing over the top.
Would you like to tell me a little bit about what happens in these dreams?
I feel like something bad is going to happen to me. I feel like something bad has happened. It hasn't reached me yet, but it's on its way. And it's getting closer. And I don't feel ready. I feel like I can't do anything.
Something appears on the horizon, matching Alice's pace as it walks toward her. She recognizes the figure to be her own bloated corpse. Identical to the one excavated from the swimming hole. And naturally, she flips out. This was the thing that really convinced me that there had to be more to this film than met the eye. A girl knowing she was going to die, running into her own corpse that was the omen solidifying her aching fear of death on her doorstep. A veritable glimpse at what was to come. This is about the end of the movie. The plot seems to be tapering off after its resolution. June has a session with magician Ray Schultz and finally gains closure. She feels as though Alice's presence has faded in the house, symbolizing their closure. They move house, and there's Alice standing in the window behind them in the last frames of the movie. Then, during the credits, footage and photos emerge of Alice's ghost really in them. even in the photos that were faked by Matthew, which I thought was kind of strange. Anyway, afterward I felt somewhat underwhelmed. It was an okay movie, nothing amazing, a few creepy parts, good acting, great cinematography. The newsreels and all the old footage they spent time dating and recreating were really good, totally justifying most of the ratings it received on the net, but there were those loose threads I couldn't place, things that didn't seem to make sense. The next few times I watched it, I began to string together some loose ends and realized the reason this whole movie is mysterious and so underwhelming at the same time is because the entire plotline, literally the entire plotline around which this whole film is edited, is one massive red herring. Red herrings are commonly seen in murder mysteries, and are used so that the audience doesn't figure out the murderer too soon. A red herring is set up to implicitly set up blame for the murder on an innocent character. Circumstantial obstructions can be highlighted and followed to elude the audience while the real killer is revealed toward the end. Most, if not all, movies that utilize the red herring trope have the characters and thus the viewers with them resolve the red herring as the false plot it is when stronger evidence is suggested. And in the end, realize what's going on. And when you find out, you might go like this.
Oh, God damn it.
Except Mr. Anderson went one further, and had every character in the film, including the characters of the filmmakers that edited the thing, buy into the movie's red herring, which was that Alice Palmer led this double life that she was troubled by, and her secret was revealed posthumously, which sounds like another shout-out to Twin Peaks to me. Due to this secret she kept, her spirit stuck around because she knew somehow that Brett Toohey would want to cover his ass enough to break into the house to steal the tape, so her spirit could crouch down in front of the camera randomly to cause June to review all the footage and on a completely different tape find Brett Toohey in the house, so she made sure her family knew about him and the tape, thus sharing her secret and freeing herself from a guilt so strong it transcended death. That reliable and foreseeable outcome, resting on a sturdy foundation of the certainty that Alice's spirit could have guaranteed that her mother would not be able to get closure from not having examined Alice's body in the morgue, because...
that's what her father does.
Thus guaranteeing that her brother, of course, would think up the obvious plan of setting up cameras to fake his sister's ghost that really existed anyway, to get her mother the closure she needed, and setting up cameras in the exact right spots, and to have someone look through the footage and in the foreshadowed background see a figure poking around in the fireplace in Alice's room. If this red herring plotline was actually the real one, then for Alice to reveal her true self, would it not have been more effective if she just told her father where the video was when he came and sat down on her bed, instead of telling him to get out? Naturally, I think it's understandable people bought into this red herring plot. After all, it's not common that you see a movie where the red herring isn't resolved by anyone in the film at all. In fact, I don't know of any film I've ever heard of that has done that before. And I've seen a lot of films, if aerobics videos from the 80s count as films. I mean, even the characters in the film's brains have been turned to slush by third-rate horror plotlines that have been churned out of the meat processor that is Hollywood. A place that literally produces films the same way McDonald's produces chicken nuggets. Put the good script in, some young writer's baby he nursed from when it was just a grammatically incorrect sentence on a post-it note on a corkboard above his desk. And like the chicken in the factory farm, pump it full of the kind of shit that will add another finger and some glow-in-the-dark teeth to your family's genetic tree. Just cram the plot full of artificial one-dimensional characters as vacuous-minded and inhumane as you'd force-feed geese to make foie gras. Stick in a plot so flimsy and so plagiarized among a market saturated by plots so flimsy and so plagiarized that actually pursuing all of the valid claims of plagiarism in court would be like attempting to arrest and penalize everyone who's downloaded music illegally since the dawn of the internet. And after the story is so chocked full of unfathomable shit, it's barely recognizable anymore, its last redeeming features are bled out onto the cutting room floor by a swift blade to the throat. Then it's dumped into a pulverizer where they throw in silicon, blonde bleach, and maybe a jawline for good measure. The result being a disgusting pink inedible mess, so it's dyed white and drenched in sex appeal, glazed over with that weird fake-looking grating that makes you feel like you're watching a movie made by an apathetic atheist neckbeard intern whose only relevant experience was making hyper-contrasted Photoshop profile pictures of himself staring down his nose condescendingly at you as if you made an entirely permissible grammatical error. Then, if you're still following this irrelevant tangent, you make a movie poster that features a still from the part of the movie where the conventionally attractive woman gets her shirt ripped a bit, then cross your fingers and pray that the film's Japanese original was good enough to get people through the door. Fact, nut. I'm not doing it.
Oh, dude, what are you doing?
Cinema is crap.
Come on.
These days. I can't do it, dude.
Have some water. Calm down. We'll go out for dinner. Come on. Then we'll continue.
You buy me dinner?
I'll buy you dinner. Here you go.
All right,
you ready?
Thanks, man.
I feel like my blood pressure's too high right now. Oh, is my face red?
Oh my goodness, that's so violent. I better leave a comment telling them the influence they could have on young children like my Tristan. You are setting a bad example.
Mom, I need stimulation.
Go watch some Oprah, dear. I'm busy.
Mom, my brain's developing.
Go watch Dr. Phil then. Goodness. Oh, and Tristan, can you get the fish sticks out of the freezer, please, for dinner? My angel-faced cherub. Mommy loves you! You are setting a bad example. So the mid-credit footage is rolling by. There's Alice in the back of a birthday party. There's Alice sitting on a bench in the backyard. And in one of them, I look in the very left-hand corner and I see Alice standing at the foot of a bed. And I thought back to the diary entry where Alice said she got out of her bed, feeling drugged and heavy and deathly alone, and went into her parents' room to stand at the end of their bed, but realized that no one could help her anymore. She was too far gone. The thing that was coming for her had drawn too near. Then I thought about her mother saying she'd had a dream about Alice coming into her room, standing at the end of her bed, hair still dripping wet from the dam, and she mentioned she was afraid to
open my eyes. I'd woken up, but I didn't want to open my eyes.
Because she felt certain she might actually see her daughter there. That footage played during the credits was captured after Alice died, perhaps even the night of her mother's dream. Then I was thinking about the other standout point of the film. Her father going into her room and sitting on her bed, seeing Alice there in her chair texting, and his foot squeaking on the floor and Alice yelling at him to get out. So then I thought, could the dream the mother had and the night Alice came into her parents' room be the same night? Anderson seems to be drawing a parallel here. But how could the same thing happen twice at different times? I thought then that before Alice died, what if she was sitting in her room doing something so normal as texting, and she felt something in her room, heard the squeak of a shoe? She'd have linked it to the growing feeling of what was coming for her, the ominous bad thing approaching that she mentioned in Ray's psychic session, that unnameable thing that hadn't reached her yet but was on its way. On both sides of Alice's death, there are three identical events that I could count. Then the theory crept up on me. Alice knew her death was coming. She'd already made that clear enough by saying,
I feel like something bad is going to happen to me. I feel like something bad has happened. It hasn't reached me yet, but it's on its way.
Alice knew her death was coming because her death had already begun. This is how I think of it. It's as if a line between life and death had become blurred. And life no longer ended where death begun, but death sort of flooded over life, and thus life over death. Death starting prematurely, and life carrying on like an echo. This explains the events that seem to happen at the exact same time on either side of her actual bodily death drowning in the dam. The aloneness expressed by Alice during her hypnotic house inspection is attributed metaphorically by the family and thus the viewer. to Alice's feeling that she has a deep, dark secret kept from the world, and no one understood her. But really, she quite literally experienced the aloneness of the grave impending before it eventually found her. She knew it was coming, and the metaphorical double life she led ended up being a literal double life. And to make this premise even more devastating, the mother takes the exact same guided meditation through the house as Alice did, during which she goes past Alice's room, looks in, and sees nothing. But in Alice's guided trance, she says she sees her mother enter her room, but her mother doesn't see her, and she leaves. And that's exactly what she does in her meditation. And as the mother walks away with the red herring, having attained the closure she sells by the seashore, and as the mother walks away with the red herring, having attained the closure she needed, secure in the idea that Alice just wanted to relay her dark secret, Alice experiences on the other side of death what was left of her life. Death yawning ever wider as she trails out toward it slowly, consciousness draining and disappearing to nothing, alone and aware of the whole thing. Mark Twain once said, "I do not fear death. I had been dead for billions and billions of years before I was born and had not suffered the slightest inconvenience from it." But the fear of death is what makes every horror movie scary. The irrational fear of the grave. That is why, in my opinion, Lake Mungo is the scariest horror film ever written. Lake Mungo grossed $29,000 in Australia. Compared to The Blair Witch Project, another groundbreaking film that pushed genre boundaries, which grossed what would be the equivalent of $350 million today after its release in 1999, I genuinely feel Lake Mungo was jibbed. And according to YouTube culture, I'm now obliged to encourage your comments. So, if you must, you can tell me what you think about this review. And though this film is modest in its approach, is it not at the end of the day more troubling than the visceral onslaught of gore and jump scares we're all used to? And though this is the only video on this channel right now, we're determined to put our whole hearts into something and bring you weekly videos. So if you're into the supernatural, satire, and general idiocy, hit subscribe and watch this space.
Actually pretty good.
Yeah, I got some balsamic if you want to try.
Yeah, show that. Yeah,
sweet. Cheers. It's kind of, am I getting drunk off this? Is this alcoholic? There's some Worcestershire sauce if you want.
Yeah, that's right.
I was trying to get Dan to play a neck beat. My direction is for him to do this, so I'm just trying to focus.
Dan actually has a fedora.
You need another one too.
Dropped it.
You need more.
Can't do it.
Oh my god. Just colour in your hands a bit.
Is this still filming?
Yeah. Failing the actual Dorito does have colours in his hands. Oh, this is the best.
Squash pie is like... That's good.